the fourth verse of Chaturshloki. You know, Chaturshloki is a very grave topic. This is so grave. Because Chaturshloki takes the whole teaching into four verses, you know. The Vedas do that. They have this aphorism. They're called sutras. Like the Vedanta Sutra. It's like the intellectual giants of India have not only given information about all the different truths, but they've also been able to synthesize all these truths into what you call, in a nutshell, very small, in a nutshell, what does it mean? You know, a nutshell is not very big, no? So you want to bring all the Gita into a nutshell? Good luck! That's 700 verses of wisdom. But the Bhagavad Gita also has a Chaturshloki. Please open the Chaturshloki of Bhagavad Gita to me, for me. Which is a very important part of Bhagavad Gita. So, and then Atato Brahma Jigyasa, that the human form of life is meant to strive for self-realization. That's in a nutshell the instruction. And prema pumarta mohan, that the supreme goal is love. That's all. Thank you. The supreme goal is love. Then, prema dama deva meva nomi gora sundarnam, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu brings this path of love to us. His path is the path of love. So, this is Gopika's japa. Where is Gopika?
Archie went to take it up.
Valerie, no chance. Du bist noch hier.
Ja, noch.
Wann geht's los?
Anderthalb, zwei Stunden.
Okay. Sprechen wir nachher. So, Gopika. Dann bringt man Gopika für ihre Einweihung. Ja? So, Chaturshloki. I personally love it. It excites me that so much divinity is compacted into such an amazing thing. Just I want to read you the Chaturshloki of Bhagavad Gita so that you understand there was another. It's like a famous thing. Chaturshloki, four most important verses of Srimad Bhagavatam, and Chaturshloki, four most important verses of Bhagavad Gita. And you should all know them by heart. Aham savasya prabhavo mata saram pravartante iti matva bhajante mang buddha bhava samanvita. I am the source of all spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me. The wise who know this perfectly engage in my devotional service and worship me with all their hearts. This is a love declaration. And it's the same, it's almost the same as the first verse of the Chaturshloki of Bhagavatam. Then he goes on, our dear Lord Krishna. Tesham satatam yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam. No. Yes. Dadami buddhi yogantam. Ye namam upayanti te. That's the second. Sorry, the third. Very thin paper. Machita Madgata Prana Bodhayantas Parashparam Katayantas Chamam Nityam Tushyanti Cha Ramanti Cha. Oh, this is a love verse. The thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me, their lives are surrendered to me, and they derive great satisfaction and bliss, enlightening one another and conversing about me. You see, if you want to get people enthusiastic about Krishna consciousness, you have to talk lovingly about Krishna and his representatives. Then people will get an idea that there's something nice to do and nice to follow. So they are deriving great satisfaction and bliss, enlightening one another and conversing about me. And then number three, Tesham satatam yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogantam yenamam upayantite. To those who are constantly devoted and worship me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me. Well, what more you want, you know? God is talking here, you know. It's all love, 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 love. He's like love bombing us. Nice. And then number four. Tesham evanukampartam aham ajnana yam tamaha nashayami atma bhavashto jnana dipena bashvataha. Now I want to know only one thing. Who of you knows these four verses by heart? Who of you has made an effort to memorize these? It must be my fault if you have not. But I don't know what to do because I did memorize them.
I have tried.
You have tried.
I forgot them.
We forgot them. Because learning these shlokas is an exercise for becoming a good preacher. Because you have to tell the people, why are you worshipping Krishna? Because he says this, that love is the supreme. I don't know. I know nowadays people are not much into shloka memorization. Maybe I'm guilty myself because I stay with my verses from the past, but I have not practiced very seriously of memorizing more shlokas. Vishnu Maharaj, who's coming tonight, he knows the entire Bhagavad Gita by heart. That's 700 verses, you know. It's so nice to know something, but it's not enough to know. It has to be more than that. But at least you have to know to begin. If you don't know, then you can't speak about something. So these are the sweet verses. Oh, I didn't read the translation. Out of compassion for them, I, dwelling in their hearts, destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born of ignorance. So Krishna confirms in the last, I love you guys. Out of compassion, I feel so sorry for all of you. Therefore, I come into your heart and I give you this transcendental knowledge. So try it. Memorize these four verses. They'll make you a perfect Bhagavad Gita preacher. Numbers?
Numbers, yes.
Chapter 10, text number 8, 9, 10, 11. Chapter 10, 8, 9, 10, 11. These are the four Chaturshloki. Now, Mahari, at least he knew what I was talking about. I could find them. That means he studies. If I tell any one of you Chaturshloki Bhagavad Gita, and you look at that book with a big question mark in your mind, that means you never studied it. You never took it serious. I don't know who to hold responsible for that. The internet or the television? I don't know. I really don't know. Probably I'm guilty myself, but I don't know. At least I belong to the old school who did memorize the slokas. So that, and I keep quoting them in my classes, so. Now the one comes. Etavat eva yigyasyam tatvach jijyanunatmana anvaya vyatire kabyam yats yat sarvatra sarvada. This is Sunday. Today's Sunday, no? So for Sunday we got
Easter.
Second chapter 9:36. It is the Osterhasen surprise. Now here comes the shloka. A person who is searching after the Supreme Absolute Truth, you. The personality of Godhead, him. must certainly search for it up to this, in all circumstances, in all space and time, and both directly and indirectly. No escape. There is no escape, Gopinath. You gotta look for Krishna everywhere. Ramayana, Mahabharata, Krishna, that's Krishna. But Krishna is not only there. He's also in the other kids, in the heart. He's also in your speech when you talk. He's also in your mom when she gives you Krishna memories. Krishna is in your surrounding. He's in the nature. Krishna is everywhere. So search him everywhere. You ask, where is Krishna? You want to know that. All of us want to know. Purport, Prabhupada says, to unfold the mystery of Bhakti Yoga, as it is explained in the previous verse, is the ultimate stage of all inquiries, or the highest objective for the inquisitive. Everyone is searching after self-realization in different ways. By karma yoga, by jnana yoga, by dhyana yoga, by raja yoga, by bhakti yoga, etc. To engage in self-realization is the responsibility of every living entity developed in consciousness. One who is developed in consciousness certainly makes inquiries into the mysteries of the self, of the cosmic situation, and the problems of life in all spheres and fields, social, political, economic, culture, religious, moral, etc. And in their different branches. But here, the goal of such inquiries is explained. The Vedanta Sutra philosophy begins with this inquiry about life, and the Bhagavatam answers such inquiries up to this point, or the mystery of all inquiries. Lord Brahma wanted to be perfectly educated by the personality of Godhead. And here is the answer by the Lord, finished in four nutshell verses from Aham Eva to this verse, Etavat Eva. This is the end of all self-realization processes. Man do not know that the ultimate goal of life is Vishnu, or the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Due to being bewildered by the glaring reflection in the darkness. Yeah, that was the first verse, no? Seeing the light in the darkness, no? And the glaring reflection. Oh, when you see a glaring reflection, you really want to go there. But it may be Maya. And as such, everyone is entering into the darkest region of material existence, driven by the uncontrolled senses. The whole material existence has sprung up because of sense gratification, desires based principally on the sex desire. And the result is that in spite of all advancement of knowledge, the final goal of all the activities of the living entities is sense gratification. But here is the real goal of life. And everyone should know it by inquiries put before a bona fide spiritual master, expert in the science of Bhakti Yoga, or from a living personality of Bhagavatam life. Everyone is engaged in various kinds of scriptural inquiries, but Srimad Bhagavatam gives answers to all of the various students of self-realization. The ultimate objective of life is not to be searched out without great labor or perseverance. One who is imbued with such sincere inquiries must ask the bona fide spiritual master in the disciplic succession from Brahmaji, and that is the direction given here. Because the mystery was disclosed before Brahmaji by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the mystery of all such inquiries regarding self-realization must be put before such a spiritual master who is directly the representative of the Lord, acknowledged in that disciplic succession. Such a bona fide spiritual master is able to clear up the whole thing by evidence from the revealed scriptures, both direct and indirect. Also, everyone is free to consult the revealed scriptures in this connection. One still requires the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master, and that is the direction in this verse. The bona fide spiritual master is the most confidential representative of the Lord, and one must receive direction from the spiritual master in the same spirit that Brahmaji received it from the personality of God and Lord Krishna. The bona fide spiritual master is that bona fide in that bona fide chain of disciplic succession never claims to be the Lord himself. Also, such a spiritual master is greater than the Lord in the sense that he can deliver the Lord by his personally realized experience. The Lord is not to be found simply by education or by a good fertile brain, but surely he can be found by the sincere student through the transparent medium of the bona fide spiritual master. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Shakshun Militam Jene Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. When I hear so much talking about the bona fide succession and the bona fide spiritual master, I start crying inside, say, my God, what can I do in this world except following Srila Prabhupada who is definitely that bona fide spiritual master. Whereas we are just trying to provide the blind uncle is better than no uncle principle. That we have to continue Srila Prabhupada's great gift to the world, because he wanted this to happen. He had so much concern for the suffering people in this world that he really made no exception when he distributed his mercy. He gave his mercy everywhere in a very unique way. So unique that it is absolutely surprising. So surprising that we cannot even imagine that Srila Prabhupada, he preached in Saudi Arabia, he preached in Beirut, he preached in Tehran, he preached in Pakistan, he preached in places where preaching is absolutely dangerous, but he preached there. He sent his disciples. We were preaching in Brazil, Argentina, Chile, Paraguay, and Bolivia. All these five countries at that time, they were under the regime of the Condor. The Condor was a program which had the official purpose was that any opposition to the system would just disappear. In the reign of the Condor, in those five countries, these five military dictatorship had a very close secret service working together, and much more than 100,000 people disappeared and never showed up again. And in the middle of that, totally dominated by the Catholic Church, who was in total union with the dictators and wanted to eliminate all the other religions competitions like they did in Germany also. In the midst of that, the devotees of Srila Prabhupada established the Hare Krishna movement, and still they're alive by magic, by Prabhupada's protection and Krishna. But all I wanted to say by doing so is that Prabhupada was not fearful to fulfill Lord Chaitanya's prophecy, because he knew that is Lord Chaitanya's plan. Therefore, I'm going to Russia. Therefore, I'm sending. Prabhupada personally sent one of his disciples to China. He said, you go to China, preach there. A sannyasi, famous sannyasi. Prabhupada had an agenda, and the agenda was preached on Mother Earth. Every country, every language. Prabhupada was somewhere else. I mean, we are just happy to preach a little bit in Göteborg and go to Imlitala, no? Or we are just happy to preach in Wroclaw and maybe publish a book, no? And then we think we are doing a big thing, no? Yeah. And I could give thousands of more examples from all of you, but I really respect your services. Don't think that I'm minimizing your service by saying that. But now compare that to Srila Prabhupada. Yeah? What he had in mind when he started his Krishna conscious movement at the age of 68, going with a bag of books, with a boxes of books to the US. No, if we call him a Shakti Avishavatar, we call him a miracle, a Senapati, a great general of Mahaprabhu's project. We are not exaggerating. Huh? We are not exaggerating. And because we are connected to Prabhupada indirectly, No, not indirectly, sorry, directly, because his books are here, his deities are there, his students are there. So we are still Prabhupada's family closely. So because we are connected to him, we are so lucky. You know, people that worship Jesus Christ, the gentleman was supposed to walk around here 2,000 years ago. And people are still fired up about him and say, hey, Jesus, 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 look. So, you see, the faith is an amazing thing, no? So we are just like now second generation, now third generation starting slowly after Prabhupada. And, I mean, we are the lucky, lucky ones, no? Like in the future, go 500 years from now, then they'll say, oh, Prem Kishore Das Brahmachari was the president in one of Prabhupada's first big temples in Berlin. Amazing. And they installed the deities there of Gandharika, Govinda Sundaram, inspired by the great sage Sridhar Maharaj, who was a godbrother of Prabhupada. You know, they will be read 500 years later, no? And then Halata made Bhagavad Gita in German poetry. Imagine that, you know. Now we're going to have also German poets involved, no? And then there were this strange guy, you know, Ambarish. And he went all over the world making altars, making the most beautiful setups for the worship of Krishna. And then he also built a Bhajan Kutir in Berlin next to the S-Bahn. Wow! That is the history of them. And we have to look a little bit in the future and then look back from there, no? And then you'll find your names there, because you are the pioneers of this. You are the pioneers who keep going and pushing forward Krishna conscious concepts. It is still an invasion, a culture invasion. This is Mlecha land. We are in Mlecha land, whatever that means. I mean, at the time of the British, when they were in Bengal, and a British man would visit a Bengali house, then it was a custom that after he left, had to wash all the house with cow dung. Because such a contaminated person had entered their house who was a meat eater. So that a cow eater, that was considered, let's get the energy out with a lot of cow dung. I mean, you may think, discrimination, disqualification, oh God, you know. Actually, when Prabhupada went to the West, many people criticized him. Why are you going to the West? What's the use of going there? These people have no idea. They cannot understand anything. They only know how to make rifles, kill people, steal their stuff, because that's what the Indians had experienced from the Europeans. They hadn't seen anything good coming. No? And nowhere in the world Europe came in to give something good. Everywhere, like you seen yesterday, the Kiva. And maybe you don't know what it means. Maybe you have no idea. Most probably it's like some kind of a culture shock to see Paramadvaiti Swami with natives from the jungle wiggling leaves and playing flutes and doing all kinds of things and speaking weird languages. I don't know what you thought about when you saw those pictures, but I tell you that I was joining with those people who have been murdered, persecuted, robbed by the white man since the last 500 years. And even today, indigenous people are being murdered in Canada, in South America, continuously, as soon as they crossing over some industrial interest oil extraction, mining interests. As soon as these people in their habitat claim some rights over their lands, their military objectives. They were the people dancing with us in Krishna's temple in Bogota. And we are white. They transcended. They're very confidential. They don't allow a camera to come into their ceremonies. They made an exception to have a documentation on the Kiva. Something surprising. Because certain things have taken place. They have been given messages from their site of inspiration that the time has come where we have to work together. And they trusted us. They ate our food. They went to the temple and danced with us. They appreciated that we opened our doors to them. And that's why this unheard of. You don't know, in that meeting, in those 4 days, native rivaling groups who had been in friction with each other for who knows how many years, because the invaders, they always used the putting one against the other principle, divide and conquer. So many of them had been in friction with each other, and those frictions were settled in Krishna's temple while eating prasada. So, that's history. Well, I tell you, this is, for me, it was much better than if they would have given the Nobel Prize to Varshana for human achievements or something. I mean, this idiotic Nobel Prize, which they give to any warmonger and any stupid cheater. No, but it's still the most recognized, the Nobel Prize of Peace, the Nobel Prize of Literature and whatever, you know? I mean, we wish Prabhupada would have received the Nobel Prize, but he was saved from it. He was saved from this terrible disprestige of this lying prize. Better Obama gets it, no? Obama the abominable. Let them have those cheated. But when I felt so honored on behalf of Srila Prabhupada, because I knew I did not deserve to be there with those natives. I had no karma or no sukriti to be in their company if I would not have met Srila Prabhupada. Otherwise, there'd be some of those idiot Germans all over South America making industries. There's lots of industries, German industries, all over Latin America. They smelled some money, some business, and there they went. Swedes are also there. But what they go for? For money and using the people. They're not going there to respecting indigenous people. Forget it. Whenever indigenous people show up, they are looked upon like scum. Oh, look how they paint their bodies. Oh, look how they have feathers, you know. They're making the stupid show of our cowboy movies. How American justifies the genocide of the native North Americans by, until today, painting them like the dangerous aborigines, and not people who defended their wives and their children, like valiant to go against these firearm people. So, really, There's no words to explain how they can trust us and share their most sacred Kiva ceremony with us for the sake of praying for the whole world. If you read the declarations of the United Nations of the Spirit, then you know what I'm talking about. And if you have not read the United Nations of the Spirit, then you must be very uninformed, or you're not my disciple, because we work all hard for something, so hard, with all our life put into this, to create a new paradigm of human existence, inspired by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's love, inspired by the Chatur Shlokis, inspired by that. We work so hard, and if you don't have any recognition or no knowledge or no interest in that, then you should just change your name and call yourself Apple Das or Android Das, or I don't know what name you would like prefer to choose, but don't call yourself Humanity and Love Das, because you don't fit that name. That name is to be gained. The Krishna Das name is to be gained and to be kept and to be defended. And I know you all must have heard, oh, Paramadvaiti Swami, he's playing with indigenous people somewhere. Huh? Who knows what he's up to? Huh? Now he's in India. What he's doing? Hang around with the yogis. Huh? Maybe he became a yogi. One man in Europe, I don't want to mention the name, he heard that we had worked for the spoon revolution for making people vegetarian. He said, oh, Paramadvaiti must become a vegetarian. They can't understand it, they can't appreciate, they don't know what's going on. It doesn't matter. Everybody's on his own level of understanding what's important. But for my disciples, not the same. My disciples, they better find out what I'm doing, because this is the cutting edge. This is what Krishna is presenting. The people, Prabhupada's disciple, Prabhupada's godbrother, they could not understand that Prabhupada was the cutting edge when he went to New York. They made fun of him. Oh, these white guys, look at these people. And it wasn't all wrong. I tell you, Prabhupada's godbrothers, they were not so wrong being suspicious of the white guys. And I tell you why. This is a very hard attack on ISKCON now, but it's on any of those white proud guys. Hare Krishna. When we went to India, the Indian people that looked at us, they said, who are these guys? Oh my God. Different people reacted differently. The Gujarati women, they threw themselves on the ground and offered obeisances and tried to touch our feet. I mean, here you go. A month before you still smoked marijuana, and now you have some Indian lady wanting to touch your feet. Please, no, you misunderstand something. No, you have japa, you have tilak, I touch your feet. That's how it works for them. But these were the ladies. Others were saying, no, these guys are CIA guys. That cannot be true. No white guy would dress like this and cut his hair and come here and say Krishna, Krishna. No. They want to invade India to steal something, for sure. Then there were the others, the smarter Brahmins. They went like, good try. Next lifetime, you can come back and be one of us. Good try, you little guys with your samskara. You're all pretty lost, but okay, at least you try to get a little mercy. Arrogance, very arrogant. Now that's what we received when we went to India. All the different reactions. One time a devotee went to a temple in Vrindavan and he gave a donation and the pujari said, "Thank you. I bless you that next lifetime you can come and be born here in a Vaishnava family, in a rich Parsi family, so you can become a real devotee." So then the devotee went back to Prabhupada and told him what the priest had told him. Prabhupada said, "Can you please go back and tell him, I bless you that next life you can be born in the West and become a member of Lord Chaitanya's mission so that you actually understand what this movement is all about." So this misunderstanding each other conflict is not new. Dinabana knows very well because he knows what they say on that side and what we say on our side and what they do in the private life and what we do in the private life. He knows the whole story, no? So he can tell a story about that. He can probably write a book called Krishna Consciousness Trying to Become West. Something like that, you know? Anyhow, my point was that we were kind of looked down upon, admired by some, and looked down upon by the intellectuals, by the smartas, by the leaders, the simple people not. So now you go from that 10 years later. What happened 10 years later? Those who were the underdogs became the new elite. Those who were Prabhupada's Western devotees, well-equipped, high-tech, good money, building big temples here and there, we started to look down upon the other Vaishnavas, who were the disciples of Prabhupada's godbrothers, and we thought, we became arrogant, very arrogant. And the ISKCON leadership until today is totally arrogant with other religious leaders in India. Like our Gaudiya Acharyas who are coming tonight, Vishnu Maharaj. Maybe they are a little polite. Really. I tell you one story, it's intimate, but Srila Bhakti Balabhtirtha Maharaj, who was all love, he went to New York and preached there. And they told him, there's ISKCON Rasa Yatra going on. So he said, "Wow, ISKCON Rasa Yatra, let's go to the Rasa Yatra." So he went to the Rasa Yatra. An elderly, top senior Gaudiya Vaishnava. And he met one ISKCON Acharya, whose name I will not mention, who he had met in India before and had some diplomatic good relationship. When that ISKCON Acharya saw Bhakti Balabhtirtha Maharaj, he looked at him and says, "Hare Krishna," turned around and let him stand there by himself. Srila Tirtha Maharaj was so hurt, so sad. He was giving him a feeling, "What are you doing here? This is our place of preaching. Huh? Like, how do you invade our New York preaching turf?" He didn't give him a smile, a hug, or invite him for prasadam, anything. And he was a top acharya of ISKCON. I tell you that so that you don't become like this. That you don't become arrogant with others. Neither with ISKCON devotees or with anybody. Don't become ignorant, arrogant, who think you can look down upon anybody. Don't commit that blunder, because you ruin your spiritual life by that. Some other, by the grace of Krishna, I was working for the Vishva Vaishnava Raj Sabha. You know why? I did that for you. Because I didn't want you to come to India and feel rejected by the Indians. Or feel rejected. Already we were rejected by ISKCON because we didn't like their administrative system. Long story. Read Search for Purity if you want to know the details. But we still love them. We never went against them. Anytime we can help them, we give them the cooking pots. One time they came to us, asked us for the cooking pot for Rasa Yatra here. Come on, take them. Then I called them, shall we also come and dance in Rasa Yatra? They said, no, better not. Okay, take our pots, but we don't have to come if you don't want to. But you see, it's about the arrogance which easily comes into you because you're belonging to a group. You think my group is better than the other group, and it doesn't work like that. No group is better than other group. Groups do not exist. Groups are fictional understanding. It's you who is Krishna conscious or not. There is no groups, there is no Hindus. There are some people believe in Sanatana Dharma, and some believe it and practice, some believe it and don't practice. And there's all kinds of things, but there are not such a thing as a Hindu, or a Vaishnava, or an ISKCON devotee, or a Vrinda devotee. There's not such a thing. It's all invention, it's all fantasy. It's only you. Who are you? What do you understand? How do you behave? And I'm deeply ashamed about my God brothers, how they think about the other Vaishnavas in India, because they've totally ignored them. They ignore the invitations to the festivities. They ignore everything. And they don't invite them either. On the contrary, there's an order out that nobody who is not from ISKCON can give a class in ISKCON. And other orders. And if you're an ISKCON member, and if you go and listen to a class from a person outside of ISKCON, your position in ISKCON becomes questionable. You may not be accepted back. That's what happened to us. We called them, he crossed over the river Ganga. So no return. It's beautiful, no? You cross over the Ganga. One of my God brothers, he wrote a poem. He said, all glories to you. You renounced the Mayapur Zoo to go to Navadvip. That's why we follow you. But don't worry. Now there's a zoo in Mayapur also, in Navadvip also. The zoo moved over. So, now we have to find another way. Okay, crossing over the Ganga, crossing over wherever, go to the essence. Don't become a classist. Don't become a racist. And if you are a racist, if you had any type of negative feeling, when you saw all these beautiful people in the Kiva movie yesterday, then you need an urgent denazification or an urgent de-racist education of Europe. Because it's in our blood, We have been taught from the beginning that we are higher and they are lower. We went to colonize, we went to give them culture. Nothing is more further from the truth than that. And I had to sit with them overnight and listen to their talks to wake up myself, even though I wasn't against them, I wasn't a racist, I wasn't a sexist, because my communist upbringing, I already had understood we are all human beings, we have the same rights and we shouldn't get on each other's case. Then I had to give up communism because they were getting on everybody's case. But I had that picture clear, but still in my heart, the prejudice had remained that somewhat primitive those people must be. But when I heard them talk and saw how they saw the world and Mother Nature and everything and how generous they were, I must tell you, I could understand they are the ones who see it and know it. We don't. We simply don't. And amazing. So I offer my obeisance to my spiritual master first, because he has opened me the eyes and given me the Chatur Shloki, my God, and amazing. But I've heard things from native speakers who are very close to Vedic revelations. You know, Veda means truth. Truth doesn't have Indian copyright. Veda is also not copyrighted. So plenty of the things taught by the natives are 100% Vedic knowledge. And you are not this body, they know it. And karma, they also know it. And reincarnation, they also know it. And that everything is belonging to one supreme energy control, they know it. And I could give you a long more list, and that only by chanting the holy names you get to the divine, they know it. Now, where did you learn about that? Well, we did, from Prabhupada. No. But didn't read from that in the university here. We didn't read anything about that from our German literature, Günter Grass or whoever the writers are. We don't get that knowledge from them. We get these from the natives, from the lovers of Mother Nature and all humanity. Maybe now you can understand why I feel honored that they came to us. Not only they came, they decided to stay. They gave the kiva to us. And they said, you are managing these things so nice, we authorize you to continue the kiva in your way after we go. Because normally a kiva is for 4 years, then it moves somewhere else. So it is my responsibility to utilize the kiva for their joy and the advancement of the people, and we already did some kivas. We are combining them with some very interesting meetings of the University of Ancient Wisdom. And that concept of the University of Ancient Wisdom is about to expand. It may even reach Meiringen one day. Who knows whether people in Meiringen want to have such a university there or not. Or it may reach Nanda Falfa. That's why I invite Gita. Come on, check this one out. Maybe we can take this even to Nanda Falfa. It may reach many more areas because it's very, very wonderful to study the ancient wisdom of the Vedas side by side with the healing and with the caring wisdom of our ancestors. Because don't forget one thing. You are all indigenous people. All of you have indigenous blood in you. Only you're so stupid you have believed in the science and think your grandfathers there were some worm or some reptile who crawled out of the ocean. You have believed that scumbag philosophy. And then you have not regarded your own ancestors. Our ancestors were not primitive. That's a lie. Maybe they were living without the modern amenities, and they were quite happy doing so. Maybe they were not so eager, or they were not tested by what we call modern society. We are being tested. In a way, we are being raped. But what to do? If that is the test we have to pass, then we have to pass it. What can we do? Within 4 or 5 years, the entire world scene is when I go to the bathroom in the airplane, when I come back, I see everybody's looking in his little machine and doing something. And there's no telephone up there. Huh? They're all captured by... I got one too. I may be preparing some work as well. It's a way, the world has turned that way. What can we do? Is that the fault of Srila Prabhupada? Or the fault of Lord Chaitanya? Or is it an advantage? Or what the heck it is? But I don't think it's much of an advantage, because it's a mind control instrument. And really, to penetrate it and to bring about a major mass movement, it will probably not be possible. It will be stopped. But you can make a mass movement by Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Parasevanam. Grassroot. And those who catch it and carry it and share it, they're part of it. So therefore, we are in a very strange world, strange time, but don't think you're better than anybody, because you aren't. And I'm not better than anybody either. Even though I may use some harsh words, it's only to wake you up, so don't get so tired. Huh? Because I'm not better than anybody. I'm just an aspiring servant of Srila Prabhupada. And I hope that my brothers from ISKCON, or from this Gaudiya Math or that Gaudiya Math, will embrace the United Nations of the Spirit and embrace the World Vaishnava Association. And that's why I'm instrumental in taking the United Nations of the Spirit to the Kumbh Mela in 2019, for that reason, so that they may embrace, because that's the 100 years anniversary of the Vishva Vaishnava Raj Shabha, since Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur has started it in Calcutta. And I want to make this offering to our Parama Gurudev by bringing the United Nations of the Spirit, which is for the whole world, has nothing to do with South America. Nothing to do with South America. I say it again, nothing to do with South America. It has to do with human responsibility in this world. Then, who knows what comes next? I have no idea. The rishis of South America are going to go back and going to take the memory of the Ganga and the Kumbh Mela. And the Indians, they're going to think about, who were these people? My God, where did they come from? Because in India, they're also, in India, they have many Adivasis of their own. And they don't, some relate with them, some do not relate with them. Just now, our Vishnu Maharaj, who's coming tonight, he has been part of many of Adivasis of Orissa state surrendering to Bhakti Vaibhav Puri Maharaj and getting strength from that connection. He can say much more about that. I never went with him to see this Adivasi Vaishnava association. But I know in Madhya Pradesh, there's many Adivasis who have a Kirtan festival yearly. They are holding something like a 20-day Kirtan festival. It is quite famous in the jungles. So there are exciting things going on there as well. We'll bring some over. And in this Kumbh Mela, we're going to have some far-out meetings never seen before. People who never thought that they'll meet. Like, I never thought I'd see in my life Bhakti Pragyan Yati Maharaj sitting on a stage with Parivrajaka Maharaj. Never I thought in this life I will see it. They were so much opposed to each other. But by the grace of Narendra Modi and Bhaktisundar Sanyasi Maharaj, who you know, he was here a few days ago, they came together and understood there. And I attacked him. I said, what are you doing? Are you wanting to disqualify all these people just because of your mistaken, your wrong education? You know, when it comes to us and India, us and South America, we are 100% indebted. Because all the opulence of Europe is stolen. This is not a rich land, really. All the natural resources they're in other places. Huh? I don't even know if Germany has a gold mine. But so much riches have been stripped off the poor in defenseless countries and cultures to simply bring it here and declare it our opulence. So there is some real trouble to understand how highly we have to respect these people, how kind we have to treat them, and how repentant we have to be for what our forefathers did, because we are not doing it supposedly, but because we are inheriting the riches of those stolen days, we do carry some responsibility. And the British are still guilty for all the things they did in India. Of course, not the recently born ones. So we have to, there has to be some deep reflection by all. And as I told you, summing it up, that looking down on other devotees who are not in your institution is the seal of approval of being a total idiot. We can give you that seal if you want on your passport. So don't be like that. That is my request. Be open, be loving, be humble. All these people are wonderful. All of you are wonderful, but you may also make some mistakes. So be humble about your mistakes. Don't keep committing them. Then one last chapter here. One last thing I like to say. We have a humble little attempt in Berlin of a temple of love of their Lordship who have come graciously out to Neu Summit with us. And there's a temple board and there's a temple president who deserves all the respect, and we have a plan of spiritual life, we request all of you to keep participating and not make silly excuses. I'm not going to the temple because I heard they didn't clean the door. I'm not going to the temple because somebody else is also not going. I can give you like a long list of pretexts I've heard why I'm not going to the temple, why I'm not giving donations. We are very good in this pretext and excuses. It's amazing. But not only, we are not the only ones. Don't think that is a German privilege. In every temple you find those people who find their excuses why they don't want to help and make something successful. And I count on you. And I request you, when you go to Berlin, do something constructive. Be part of the solution. Or please simply shut up and open something else somewhere else. If you want to, you're welcome. I have 24 temples in Bogota. Because I have 24 people who are speaking so loudly they want it better, go ahead, do it. Now at least they were bold enough to say, okay, Gurudeva said I should do it, now I have to do it. Now bring those 24 people for the monthly Bogota meeting. That's a good trial. It works. They're coming, they are understanding. It's so easy to criticize a community, so easy to criticize a spiritual master, so easy to criticize a temple administration, but not so easy to make your own program and to get something going. But why not? We have plenty of potential programs there in Berlin. One of the ex-temple presidents, she has made the big Kita movement in Berlin and she's managing well. Amazing, I went to see her work. Wow. She learned how to do that in Europe, in Germany. So we can do a lot of things. All of us have a great potential. But whatever you do, be generous and charitable with this temple we established. I established that temple for my spiritual master in Berlin. Maybe say funny when somebody says I, because I have no position. My I stands for community. The spiritual master's name always stands for community. It doesn't stand for him. And if it does stand for him, yes, then it stands for Srila Prabhupada. He did the temple in Berlin. He deserves all the credit. His blessings are sustaining us. And all of us who are here, all of us, should be grateful. Grateful and cooperative. And that's the same for any other little temple, medium temple, small temple. Doesn't matter where. Prague. Vienna. It's all Prabhupada's. We are simply little nothings. And we are very lucky when we can fortify the Vishwa Vaishnava Raj Sabha to have great Vaishnava friendships. A Vaishnava friendship is based on our common interests. Hinduism is based on common interests, common needs. So, we are so expert in discussing the differences and what divides us. But we don't take the time to find our common interests and defending them together. That that we don't find time for. We only discuss, oh, what makes us different? What are our different interests? Your different interests, they don't interest me at all. I just wish you well that you can accomplish your interests. But our common interests, I'm very interested in them. And Vrindavan act now, that's our common interest. And Varshanaton is our common interest, if you want it to be part of your interest. It's our Mulamat. And the Kiva, consciousness, United Nation of the Spirit, is our common interest. If you know what spirit means. If you don't know what spirit means, then you definitely not member yet of the United Nations of the Spirit. Because you may be thinking it's the United Nations of some matter. No, there's no matter. And there's no institution, there's no high-rise buildings. It's the high-rise of the love, spirit we got by our Divine Masters. Thank you very much for your attention, and excuse me for not being able to explain it better. Haribol.